How he loves us, how he loves us all.
You can be seated. Thank you. Welcome, friends, to this service of witness to the promise of the resurrection of the life of Michael James Bobo. Mike entered into glory on February 24th, 2004. Hear these words of hope and resurrection from the scriptures. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made the heavens and the earth. Jesus said, I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. I have the keys of death and Hades, and because I live, you also will live. Come to me, Jesus said to his followers. All you who are weary and carrying heavy burdens, I will give you rest. King David wrote, God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. So with confidence that the Holy Spirit is indeed present with us in this hour, let us worship the living God, the source of all hope and comfort. Let us pray. Our gracious and loving God, we come before you today to worship you and give you thanks for the life of our brother in the faith, Mike Bobo. Lord, this is a bittersweet time. Sweet, because we know Mike is healed and whole and worshiping in your presence, seeing you, Jesus, face to face, something we who follow Christ long for. But it is also bitter, for while we do have this hope of the resurrection, hope of being reunited one day, we live on this side of the veil between heaven and earth, and we miss Mike being present here with us. Help us in this hour to celebrate his life, his witness to your love and grace, but also to grieve, to weep with his family. We are thankful for your presence, Holy Spirit, as we seek to bring comfort through the reading of your word and the singing of your praise, for we do not grieve as people without hope. We love you and worship you as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Be the anchor of our souls this day. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. I'd like to introduce Nia to you. She's one of our worship leaders here at Grace Chapel. She will lead us in the singing of I Can Only Imagine.
What it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I perish for you, Jesus? Or in to my knees will I fall, will I sing hallelujah, will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. Oh, I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. I can only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only I'm not afraid to die. to my knees with love.
Hello? This is terrifying. All right. I wanted to start by saying a few things on behalf of my brothers and I. First, we wanted to say thank you for all the messages that have been sent our way over the last few days. We want you all to know that sometimes it can be hard to respond in a time like this, but please know they've meant the world to us. We also wanted to thank our friends and family from Belmont Hill, as well as the Dexter Southfield School. But most importantly to us, we wanted to thank our P&G family who might be here today. My dad really loved you guys, and you're all awesome, so thank you. I wanted to say my brothers and I are doing all right. Some days are hard, but some days Jake will proclaim at the dinner table that Pop is certainly having a cold one with with Buddy T and George right now. That, of course, is met with Matt claiming that George is probably more of a seltzer guy. Anyway, I had a pretty not great speech written when my pretty awesome Aunt Jamie asked me what I would say if I knew he was listening to every word. So I figured I would start over and share with you all a story from just last year that helped open my eyes to the beauty and, in my opinion, the perfection that was my dad. Last August, I was at school at a football practice, and I had taken a false step, I guess, and ended up tearing basically everything in my left knee. And after the surgery, I became very angry. I was probably a pretty heinous guy to hang out with. But as my dad was teaching me to walk again and to shower on my own, he would always say, Lou, God has a plan for this. You can't see it right now, but God has a plan for this. Of course, that made me more angry. But as the days went on and the days turned to weeks, I started to see something that I'd never seen before. I was seeing my dad from a different point of view. I got to see my dad when nobody else was there, when nobody was home. when he thought nobody was watching. What I saw was a man who was proud beyond words. I saw a man who was over the moon about being able to wear the Dartmouth green again for my little brother Mac, and to be part of a new community, the Dartmouth rowing community. I got to see the joy on my dad's face when he would tell his peers that he saw a little kid running around in a Seahawks jersey with 19 on the back. More importantly, though, I got to hear my dad say how proud he was of the men that his boys have become. That one I know because he told me. So, in a weird way, I couldn't be happier that my knee went to toast that day. So, Dad, I guess you were right about that plan, and I see that now. Okay, that's the hardest part. I'm sure there are some people here today that wish they'd said more to my dad, maybe in their last conversation, or maybe wish they'd said something sooner. I too have some regrets like that. But I don't regret the last things we said to each other. He grabbed me when I was rushing out of the hospital that evening, probably for something stupid, and he said, Lou, I love you. Thanks for hanging out with me, and I'm so glad you're my boy. So I'll hold that until I talk to him again someday. For that, Dad, thank you. The last thing I would like to do on behalf of my dad and his stubborn middle child is to challenge the other dads in the room here today. I would like to say that I hope you all tell your sons and daughters that you love them so much and that you're so proud of them, because that meant the entire world to me. So, Pops, I love you, and I'm glad I'm your boy. Thanks.
Short reading of the scripture, Acts chapter 20, verse 24. However, I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task that Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace.
Oh, Lukey. I feel like we say that so often in our house, oh, Lukey, with different intonations on the, oh, Lukey. But that one was really, oh, Lukey. That was really beautiful. Good job. You know, I watched my sister Jamie, who has been an absolute rock for me over these last 2 months. I watched her a year and a half ago honor her most beautiful son, George. Well, her and Brian. At his memorial. And I thought, that's the way to do it if you can, to really honor the person that you love. That's the way to do it. But this may be too hard for me. And I cry pretty ugly, so beware. We appreciate you coming to celebrate, Mike. I don't really understand how in the world we got here. But as I work through that, I do know this thing for certain.
Mike would be so thrilled to see all of you. All of the people that he loves in this church. He loved nothing more than being with his family and being in this particular place of worship. We are here today to celebrate a man of great faith and steadfast integrity. He was the most beautiful human being and servant leader to his core, who put absolutely everyone's needs in front of his own, unless he was trying to get to a Seahawks game, in which case, all bets were off. I spent a lifetime learning from my husband. I think he may have been frequently frustrated that I sometimes was a slow learner, but he kept trying, knowing I had great potential to be as kind, empathetic, and generous of spirit like him. He would reach out and hold my hand all the time. He loved to hold my hand. Sometimes just to remind me of his love, but sometimes just to say, hey, slow down. Be still. Enjoy this moment. As I think back over these last few weeks, I'm trying to capture every one of those moments. I'm so hopeful that I slowed down. But one of the best lessons he taught me and the boys was that expressions of gratitude will save us from sadness and darkness and self-pity. I have not been saved from occupying those spaces of darkness lately. But I will employ his lessons by thanking all of you for coming here to support and love us. Our family has felt so encouraged and honored through all this. And through the pain, we've felt your love from every direction. Thank you, Pastor Ruthie and Brian and the worship team. Thank you, Grace Chapel, for being such a source of inspiration and fortification for my husband. He truly loved it here. I want to thank Mass General Cancer Center. You don't ever want to be on the 9th floor of the Lunder Building. But we really felt like we were at the Four Seasons of hospital stays there. And the people there, the people were just incredible. Our nurse, Michaela, who was with us through the hardest parts, and Leslie, our palliative care nurse, who shared her love of Jesus in a way that made my husband feel just a little bit stronger for just a little bit longer. And the wizard that is the chief of oncology, Dr. Choi, in true Bobo fashion, we threw a version of liposarcoma at that doctor, the likes of which he told us he'd never seen. But Dr. Choi attacked it with us the best he could, even for such a short period of time. And finally, and I hope he's here, to Dr. Vespiano at Newton Wellesley Hospital. We kept arriving at that ER, and he kept caring for us, with calls on the weekends and even engaging his wife in our care. To Mick and Matt, Mike's brother and sister, thank you for coming at just the right time. You knew, somehow you knew. And you were here with us and with him, which gave him so much comfort. He was so proud of you both, of your genuine hearts and your beautiful families and the way that you always put family first. He adored and craved that time with you when you'd make him laugh by saying all the things that he would never say but really wanted to. Thank you, Papa, for making Mike into the father and the husband that he was. You are his hero, his knight in shining armor. And everything that he represents was inspired by you. And to Mima, as much as I believe that Mike was my soulmate, your soul and his were intertwined in ways that only God knows. And that was such a beautiful thing to me. The way he cherished me was in direct relation to his deep connection to you. And I will always be grateful for that. I love all of you Bobos. We will always be the Bobo 8 text thread. And to Jer, thank you for showing up, even when he told you not to. It will shock not one of our Dartmouth crew here today to know that Jerry Gilbert refused to take no for an answer. You stepped into the abyss with us, and you told the boys stories about their dad. You made us laugh, and you loved on us, and you prayed with us. If there's a model for our boys from both you and my husband, it is that you show up, you be dependable, and you show your love outwardly. To our amazing Jordan Reddick. I hope you're here, Dr. Jordan Reddick. You have floated above and within our heartache over these last 2 years, like the sweet medical angel that you are. You told us the hard truth when it's what we needed, and you gave us the most amazing hugs, and you sat on the floor of the emergency room with me, which was kind of gross now that I think about it. You have become as close to a sister as anyone could be, and we love and appreciate you. I'm thankful to Mike for making me feel like I was the luckiest girl in the world. He was the best human being I've ever known. He was the love of my life. For a quiet guy, he loved so loud. I'm thankful that he loved me. I'm thankful that he took care of me and let me care for him. I remember our first date at Dartmouth, our junior year. I actually asked him on the date. Yeah, I know. Surprising to absolutely no one here. I was forward. I was forward and aggressive. It was my sorority spring formal, and I needed a date. So I went to the most beautiful woman I knew, Kirsten Tevens. And I said, help me. I don't have a boyfriend. I don't have a date. What do I do? She said, I've got something that will definitely work. And she ran up the stairs of her house, and she returned with an SMU sweatshirt. She said, the cutest guy at Dartmouth was the captain of her husband Buddy's football team, and his name was Mike Bobo, and his dad played football for SMU, so he will definitely say yes if you show up in this sweatshirt. Of course, I knew exactly who Mike Bobo was because he was at more sorority formals than I had ever been. And I was in a sorority. But honestly, what did I have to lose? So I went to his room with the sweatshirt on, and he wasn't there. But Russ Torres, his roommate, was there. So I said, hey, Russ, what do you think? You think you'll go with me? Russ was a gentle and brilliant giant, an offensive lineman, and a man of few words. And he just looked at me, and then his eyes wandered over to Mike's desk in the corner. I followed his gaze to the desk and saw a plate full of cupcakes left by another girl. Telling Mike to have a great day. Then Russ looked back at me like, sorry, kid, this probably isn't going to go your way. I got the message and I headed for the door with my shoulders slumped, only to run into the man himself, Mike Bobo, walking down the hallway, double strapping his backpack like the cutie pie he was. He had the biggest smile on his face and he said, "Hey, are you a Ponies fan?" In my mind, I'm thinking, am I what? And it's going through my mind, ponies, 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 ponies. And out comes, "You mean horses?" He said, "No, I mean the ponies." And he pointed to my sweatshirt. Well, as a New England girl, I had never even heard of SMU. I thought tumbleweeds flowed over all of Texas. So it would have been awesome if Kirsten had told me that the SMU mascot was the ponies, but she didn't. So I just looked down stupidly at my sweatshirt and I figured it out. Oh yeah, I am a huge Ponies fan. I just love the ponies. Oh, and by the way, would you want to go to the Kappa Formal with me? But you're probably going, but if you want to go, but maybe you haven't said yes yet, but you probably have, so no big deal. Okay, I'm done. And he stopped me, like he did for the next 32 years. And he just helped me take a breath. He grabbed my hand, and he slowed me down. He said he'd love to go with me. And that was it. That was the beginning. I am so thankful to Kirsten. And she's told me repeatedly that she takes full credit for the marriage and the boys and everything, as she should. I'm also thankful to Russ Torres for the cupcake challenge. Here's to Russ, even though he works for Kimberly Clark. Which is a terrible idea because he's literally taking money from my baby's P&G stock. I am so thankful to my sisters and my mom. I can't even imagine any of this without them. Jim or Cole Whit, Mom, you are my safe harbor. And it's gone a little stormy lately. I just love you, and I'm so thankful for your beautiful families. Mikey reveled in your children, and he counted your husbands as a few of his very best friends, and for which I am eternally grateful. And finally, I am so extraordinarily thankful and proud of our boys, Jake, Luke, and Mac. Lately, boys have started treating me a little bit like a pet. They aren't really comfortable with me being out of their sight. And I have two very large humans sleeping with me in the big bed. I'm not sure I'm supposed to tell anyone that. But when there are two children over 6'4" sleeping in a bed with you, alone is the very last thing you feel. Very crowded is exactly what you feel. I listened to a podcast before all this happened, but I haven't been able to stop thinking about it since. It was an interview with Stephen Colbert, who said that he learned to love the thing he wished most had not happened. Love the thing he most wished had not happened. I can't even fathom that. But he went on to reference J.R. Tolkien. What of God's punishments is not a gift? It's a gift to exist, and with existence comes suffering. There's no escaping that. If you're grateful for your life, then you have to be grateful for all of it. You can't pick and choose what you're grateful for. So what do you get from loss? You get awareness of other people's loss. And this is for our boys especially. In your relationships with your wives and your children and your friends, you have to know that everyone suffers. And however imperfectly, our suffering can help to acknowledge and connect with them in their pain and love them more deeply and in ways that makes you grateful for the fact that you've suffered so you can know that about other people. Love them more deeply, right? That's the point. You develop gratitude for the pain of grief. It doesn't take the pain away. It doesn't make grief less profound. In some ways, it makes it more profound because it allows you to look it in the face. You can examine it in a way that isn't unbearable, or the red-hot sadness that we feel right now. You love Dad, and you were loved by him so deeply that the grief we feel is all that love that we didn't get to pour out on him. A broken heart is a heart that was deeply loved, and ours is broken. But it's Dad's gift to us that our suffering binds us in a way that's deeper than it might have been, that we can also empathize more acutely, maybe? I don't know. And I don't know if I can get there, but the concept gives me a glimmer of hope that we will come through this and we will never be fully whole, but we'll have this insight and hope that the red-hot sadness doesn't stay, but is replaced by the gratitude of having been deeply and ferociously and loudly loved by your father. I got a letter last week from Jeff Marchant, maybe the greatest high school English teacher of all time. And he reminded me of Wordsworth's words and intimations. Though nothing can bring back the hour of splendor in the grass, of glory in the flower, we will grieve not. Rather, find strength in what remains behind, in the primal sympathy which, having been, must ever be, in the soothing thoughts that spring out of human suffering. The same poet noted, not without hope we suffer and we mourn. Mar was right. That's our hope, right there. And if your dad taught you anything, it is to connect deeply, to be empathetic, to have grace, however we get there. You, perhaps we together, and all of us are his legacy now, and that's not a burden, it's his gift to us. You boys are the arrows in his quiver, and he was so proud of you. And you heard this all the time, almost daily. It was not for what you did, but for who you are, for the way you treat people. As he referenced in Psalm 127, verse 3 through 5, "Lo, children are a heritage of the Lord, and the fruit of the womb is his reward." As arrows in the hand of a mighty man, so are children of the youth. Happy is the man that hath his quiver full of them. They shall not be ashamed, but they shall speak with the enemies at the gate. Mike was so grateful to be your dad, to be your brother, to be my husband, and to be your son, to be all of your friend. He inspired me every day, even the day after his second surgery on January 12th, and I was taking him home from the hospital, and we knew that the cancer was everywhere and viciously growing. As we walked out of the hospital, and I'm feeling all kinds of angry and resentful and frustrated, I'm pounding on my phone for sarcoma treatment outcomes. The sun was just setting, but it was freezing cold. He grabbed my hand and he said, "Honey, look at that orange sky. And it's after 5 o'clock. We're moving in the right direction. Great expectations." May we all have great expectation for the days ahead. And while we cry on the side of heaven, he is not crying. He's okay. And I will take comfort in that.
Thank you.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
This is When Great Trees Fall by Maya Angelou. When great trees fall, rocks on distant hills shudder. Lions hunker down in tall grasses, and even elephants lumber after safety. When great trees fall in forests, small things recoil into silence, their senses eroded beyond fear. When great souls die, the air around us becomes light, rare, sterile. We breathe briefly. Our eyes briefly see with a hurtful clarity. Our memory, suddenly sharpened, examines, gnaws on kind words unsaid, promised walks never taken. Great souls die, and our reality, bound to them, takes leave of us. Our souls, dependent upon their nurture, now shrink, wizened. Our minds, formed and informed by their radiance, fall away. We are not so much maddened as reduced to the unutterable ignorance of dark, cold caves. And when great souls die, after a period, peace blooms, slowly and always irregularly, Spaces fill with a kind of soothing electric vibration. Our senses, restored, never to be the same, whisper to us. They existed. They existed. We can be. Be and be better, for they existed.
Had to stop and see Casey on the way up here to see if I could just glean a little bit of what she has. And I have to admit that following her is not where you want to be on the agenda. And aunt slash sister Jamie gets a big assist for the third time today, in addition to the nice tie I got this morning. Shortening my remarks by a fair amount, because I probably would have been up here for the balance of the afternoon. She saw draft one. Hello, everyone. I am deeply humbled and extremely grateful to have the opportunity to speak to you today, representing, among others, Mike and Casey's very large Dartmouth family. My name is Jerry Gilbert, and Bo, as I called my dear friend, was my guy in every way. 3 weeks ago tomorrow, I went to visit him at the charming Bobo home in Wellesley. He was understandably reluctant. I think that's an understatement based on what Casey just shared, to have any visitors, and perhaps especially someone who has known him for more than 35 years as the stud that is Mike Bobo. And I don't use that term lightly. I was nervous, as I am now. I knew my friend was really hurting and scared of the unknowns, which he had shared with me when he first told me of his diagnosis, and the pit in my stomach that started to form then had only grown in the ensuing weeks. Many of us here today and listening from afar believe that if anyone could overcome this monumental misfortune, it would be him. For the few weeks prior, I had basically begged him to let me come give him a hug. A couple canceled plane tickets, proof. For me, because I desperately needed one, but for him too. While the boundless love of his family is all he ever needed, something kept telling me that we just had to connect. I knew things were really tough, but I certainly did not know every detail of the complications he had to endure after the surgery on January 12th. He was careful not to alarm those of us who were loving him from afar, only suggesting that our prayers were welcome. So we prayed. When I walked into the home and saw Casey, which was great hug number one, then into the living room where Mike and Luke were sitting, it all became so very real. What he was up against, and how powerful and relatively peaceful he remained. How palpable the love was in that room. How despite being severely compromised physically, he had not lost a shred of his grace, his dignity, or even his swagger. And the man had swagger. Since then, I have thought about the iconic Jimmy V speech. Cancer cannot touch my mind, it cannot touch my heart, and it cannot touch my soul. I stared at a man with the same resolve in his eyes on February 18th, just 6 days before he passed. Mac was there too, and then Jake joined us. More bear hugs. Jake and Luke headed out to, of course, catch footballs from a local quarterback. So Mike, Casey, Mac, and I got to spend an hour chatting. There were several moments of levity with the old stories, and it was fun to share a few special memories with Mac from when his dad began his Dartmouth journey, as Mac's is just now unfolding. I knew I was there on behalf of so many people to tell him how much we love him. As we hugged, I kissed him on the head at least a few times. I honestly did not want to let go. And then, as the captain took the reins in the room, the most beautiful thing happened. His words came methodically and so thoughtfully as he held my hands in prayer with his, which basically engulfed mine, as you might imagine. He proceeded to give thanks to the Lord for what and whom I represented in that room, for all his friendships and the love that was showering down upon him and his family. I sensed that it was somewhat overwhelming for him, a man who literally never made anything about himself. I can imagine even his discomfort with everyone here today celebrating him. He just wanted to be the teammate. But in that moment, he sincerely wanted everyone, and I mean everyone, to know how grateful he was at a time when, in his words, he was literally hanging on day by day, hour by hour. How remarkable is that? I want to wish everyone here well. Thank you, Pastor Ruthie and Pastor Brian as well, as I know Mike was close to Pastor Brian. I especially want to send best wishes to Mike's parents, Keith and Barb, Papa and Mima to their grandchildren. Barb, we send you so much love today, as well as to Mike's sister, Mickey, and brother, Matt, and their families, to the entire Bobo support system of Texas that helped shape him in his adolescence. I think everyone here would like to see the playbook you used because the output was so stunning. To Parney, Gammy or Gam to her grandkids, David, may he rest in peace, known as Bumpy to his grandkids, Jamie, Cully, Witt, and your families, as well as the rest of the Hagerman crew that I know extends from New England to my home state of Oregon. A web of love like your family offers is a complete unicorn, and I have personally felt its tailwinds on more than one occasion. To Jake, Luke, Mac, and Casey, our admiration for the family you built together with your dad and husband is profound. We are so grateful to be part of your lives as you move forward with courage, which was Mike's way. Michael James Bobo of Longview, Texas, the son who grew up wanting to play football at SMU, where his father was an outstanding running back and quarterback. He somehow veered slightly off course and ended up in Hanover, New Hampshire. All thanks to this transcendent guy named Buddy Tevens. Sounds like his wife got a pretty good assist in this whole deal too. Who walked into his living room back in the winter of 1988. Some of us here can vividly recall our first Coach T encounter. Ironically, given what we know about Tevens' time, he was late that evening. He began his familiar, emphatic, Dartmouth is a special place speech around 11:30 p.m. He always hit the right notes with his audience, and of course, the Bobos loved every bit of it. So began a life-changing relationship with Coach T. Footnote, Yale came up just short in the Bow Lottery, just as they did a few years later when he secured a game-winning touchdown catch in the Yale Bowl, courtesy of Jay Fiedler somewhere in the audience. So we count Mike and Casey's beautiful family as yet another one kindled by this incredibly dynamic man with Dartmouth green coursing through his veins and whose greatest weapon was his brand of enthusiasm. Coach G showed up the right way every day and made you want to get on board. Bo got on board in a big way. The relationship between Bo and Coach T was a loving and symbiotic one for the ensuing 35 years. They spoke each other's language and had very similar core values. They now rest in peace together, both way too soon, but I know many of us are grateful that they have each other. These are two Dartmouth giants. To Kirsten Tevens and her family, we love you and look forward to celebrating Coach T in May. Mike's spirit will very much be with us in the Hanover spring air that weekend. And I will have a bed next to me reserved for him. Like others here, I met Bo in the fall of 1988. A more brash, impulsive kid from Oregon and a more measured, low-key one from Texas. At least outwardly, but I would quickly learn of and admire the fire that burned inside him. Laughter came easy for us, and from the moment I heard his deep-throated booming laugh, I was hooked. He got my irreverent sarcasm, and I appreciated his exceptionally quick wit, albeit sprinkled with manners. And he wasn't afraid to tell me when I crossed a line, as good friends should. I was born in Big D and a longtime Cowboys fan, so we shared that, as well as a hope that we were, in fact, Dartmouth's quarterback of the future. for about 4 days. Gilbert, you're a wide receiver now. Bobo, you're a tailback now. Yes, he was a tailback before he was a world-class wide receiver. What? Sharky still gets to be a quarterback? Castantine, too. I saw him earlier. Bo rolled with it, quote, on and off the field, which became one of his favorite sayings. He did not let the position change, which was beyond his control, affect his effort level, his preparation, or his performance on the field, all of which were within his control. Sounds like simple stuff that many of us fail to understand. He just figured he'd kick ass regardless. Pretty good life plan. Bo the athlete was a silky smooth glider. Lots of friends have sent me notes, but Kirk Mills, a 91 DB, sent me a note that simply read, "Trying to cover him sucked." Which I thought, we did one-on-ones in practice every day, and I can remember Kirk having a lot of trouble with Bo. In fact, I was laughing, this button that we had made, this poor defensive back from Lehigh is kind of suffering the same fate. Like, Bo's kind of like, yeah, I caught it, and yes, it's six. So, what separated him the most? I believe his vision, his sense of space and time, his ability to anticipate, and his football IQ. All were off the charts. Then there are those hands. Wow. I saw him make catches every day in practice that were not normal, but you had to pay attention because he made the extremely difficult look very easy. He did not drop the ball ever. Yes, he was a phenomenal route runner, but when he came out of his break, he literally had the ability to track the ball to its destination, the catch point, without needing to reach for it until the last possible moment when those gigantic mitts would swallow it up. And the bigger the moment, the better he was. Grace under pressure. Big play after big play after big play. Sitting with Mike at Jake's games last fall, you could feel that internal fire burning. The leg bouncing up and down, the eyes laser focused. He's literally pre-snap reading every play. Formation, motion, initial movements. He sees all of it and instinctively senses what is coming. He also knew what didn't work well for him. I laugh thinking about our daily workout sophomore summer. He looked at a squat rack like it had an infection. Smart guy, those of you with knee and back pain now. Y'all think that will help you? This is so funny. Y'all think that... I can literally remember him saying this in our old school weight room. Y'all think that'll help you catch more balls, he asked rhetorically. You can see his like. He's going out, running around. Because I had the unique fortune of being Mike's teammate, I know how that word came to life for him. He was the quintessential teammate, not just in football, but in everything. This is uniformly felt by everyone in Mike's life. I spoke to a number of his colleagues, or a number of people close to him, from his dad, Keith, to his P&G colleagues, Paul Edmondson and Tom Kunsel, and I met Tim Linehan this morning as well, to my friends and teammates, to his sister-in-law, to William Bagley, his co-coach for many years with Lawrence Pop Warner, who I met last night, so I'm there, to a former Dartmouth coach, to Greg DeRosier, who I got to meet this morning, a former player turned de facto fourth Bobo son, his words. And it was an absolute pleasure to have every conversation. These are wonderful human beings, all of whom have been so completely enriched by their time in Mike's life. The anecdotes I heard just kept reinforcing the hidden in plain sight qualities of Mike Bobo. First and foremost, he was relentlessly committed to lifting up others. We've heard that today. His wife, his kids, his colleagues, his customers. Shout out to the BJ's crowd somewhere in here. His players, his friends, and his parents and sister and brother. Keith shared that every single Sunday night in college, he called him and Barb to, if nothing else, tell them he wanted to hear their voices. Who does that? They, along with Mickey and Matt, had a nightly FaceTime that began around Christmas last year when this all became so real. They stayed connected. After that last FaceTime on February 23rd, during which he reminded his mom, who has been in her own battle with cancer for a couple years, to quote, "fight on, fighter," he sent a text to his family that read, Great to see everyone tonight. Love y'all. Thank you, Lord, for your promises and for my beautiful mom, dad, sister, and brother. William, his Pop Warner coaching mate, and Greg, his former player, were both effusive in describing the optimism and positivity with which Mike did everything. He always saw the bigger picture in working with kids. Greg kept saying that he was a safe place, a father figure, and an inspiration for him to do his best in life. A team motto took root for the Lawrence Pop Warner Hurricanes. Shout out to all the LPW alumni here today. Your best is always good enough. Less than your best is never acceptable. What an on-target message to kids. Not about outcome, which we cannot control, but always about effort, which we can. Sounds a lot like Mike Bobo the athlete, and Mike Bobo the P&G leader, and Mike Bobo the father. It sure is easier to be a role model when you walk the talk. He even got into character, as we saw in the montage of photos, to make his point about positivity. The P&G boys shared a fun photo of Mike as Ted Lasso with me. You guys noticed he nailed it. Where he apparently entertained an audience for 15 minutes at a recent company gathering, and I would love to see that video. When asked how he was doing throughout his life, Bo's lasso-like response was often, "Better than I deserve." There you go. And that included recently when he was really hurting. Right after Mike shared his diagnosis with me, I wrote down some thoughts appealing to a higher power, as on target or misdirected as that may have been. In addition to admonishing whatever forces conspired to have the absolute wrong guy be afflicted with such a horrible disease, I mostly sought a sense of peace for him and his family. We all especially feel this today for Casey, Jake, Luke, and Mac. And I know we are all a big part of making that happen, for which Mike will be eternally grateful in the years to come. Team Bobo, please know that this group, this army of support, is here for you, day by day, hour by hour. And all this began because, as my 19-year-old brain saw it, two hotties hooked up in Hanover. My 54-year-old brain doesn't really look at it that differently, to be honest. Men are simple, in case you ladies didn't know that. Yes, Michael James Bobo, like Case, was a catch. Sparks probably started over an organic salad and smoothie in Collis. I didn't know about the other thing. Though Bo likely picked up chicken tenders from the hop along the way. One can speculate. A better setup from Jimmer follows. Quote, "Well, see, the first time I met him was their sophomore summer. Case was staying at the Tevens house, that little yellow house out on Route 10. Remember that house? Anyway, she had a little gathering for some friends, and Mike was there, but at the time I had no idea they were dating. I was a snot-nosed 12-year-old tomboy who was up visiting my big sis while she worked at Dartmouth hockey camp, and I was her camper. Fast forward, senior year, homecoming, we all came up. We knew Case and Mike were serious, but we were instructed to, quote, play it cool. I remember watching Mike up at the podium in front of Dartmouth Hall, where he eventually proposed to Case, with the bonfire rising steadily behind us. When she looked away, I snuck off to the side of the crowd to get a better look at this guy who clearly enraptured her heart. And as I approached and saw those cheekbones, and then that hair, my goodness, it was all too clear. Our entire family had to play it cool, because there was no way we were going to scare away this one. We always joked with Mikey about his red solo cups, Dartmouth signature, his very quiet demeanor, his ability to look at the absolute chaos that is the Hagerman girls and just smile while probably saying, these women are too much for anyone to handle. Thank God they have each other. We often tried to get him to dance, and he never were in the Kaigam basement. He did dance once in a while. And there was that spring break he went to Florida, and though I never saw it, he was on MTV Spring Break. I mean, Mr. Captain, Ivy League champ, married to Case, three amazing boys, dancer on MTV Spring Break. He did it all. The three amazing boys part. Casey and Mike raised three exceptional people, and I've been blown away by them today as I have been in the past, mostly watching them grow up from afar. Their loving and supportive relationships with one another and their parents are perhaps the coolest part of the whole thing. That does not happen by accident. It is what all parents hope for their children and themselves. Quality begets quality, and these boys had such good role models in how their parents connected with one another and with each of them. Because showing is so much easier than telling, Mike and Casey passed along their passion for their pursuits to the boys, who have in turn followed suit. It's good to have things to chase. As Jimmer described, Mike set the bar very high, and the boys chased it. With all that encouragement and love, why not? Mac chose a sport in rowing that is the essence of team, where anonymity is the only way to thrive. Do your part to help the boat go as fast as it can, together, one stroke at a time. He now proudly wears the green and white, and I know how thrilled Mike was as he began his freshman year in Hanover. Mac's curiosity about science and medicine has no doubt been stoked further at this point, something we talked about a few weeks ago. Like Dad, he is headed for big things. Mike told me often about how proud he was of Luke's resilience. He earned every bit of his way to Williams academically, which is no easy task, an understatement as he focuses his studies in both English and history. His love of football has been confronted with an injury, as he described, and like Dad, a position change, but he keeps grinding and staying positive like his role model. Well done, Luke. And one more thing, my man. From my vantage point, you carry with you your father's striking features, a stroke of very good fortune for you. Jake's journey, which includes an economics degree from Duke, by the way, has been so fun to cheer for as he chases his dream and generously takes us along for the ride. Because he plays a kid's game with the joy of a kid, which I believe comes directly from Mike and Casey's passion as athletes. Mike played with joy every single time he stepped onto the field, including the practice field. And Case no doubt did the same on a sheet of ice. We went to Jake's game against SC in the fall of 2022. UCLA lost a close one, and post-game, long after everyone had cleared out, there was Jake in full pads running around on the Rose Bowl field with his little cousins playing touch football. Literally never seen anything like this. Football and family all wrapped into one beautiful moment. Mike Bobo was a father whose love for his children made them realize that anything is possible, just as Keith and Barb had provided for him. What a healthy cycle the boys now carry forward with them. Jimmer went on to say that Mike's constant presence in her life was a rock that helped her family navigate the unimaginable, and that he is one of the truest life anchors she will ever know. Anchor. Greg used the exact same word in describing Mike. We wear ties today because of that symbol being so impactful. For me, he was like my favorite old sweatshirt, right after it comes out of the dryer. Something you want to have on as often as possible because of the feels it gives you. Comfort. The warmth I felt every time we connected over the years, and we did so often, and the ability we had to seamlessly switch gears from levity to heartfelt connection about what was happening in our respective lives. Friends like that are so incredibly rare. Echoing Greg, my wife recounts that Mike was her male safe place in college, someone to talk to about most anything, including her then neurotic boyfriend. He is a big reason, honestly, why our relationship began to flourish, because I think he decoded some of me for Christina. There are friendships, and then there is being Mike Bobo's friend. Seemingly every college game my girls played in came with a follow-up note from him, something encouraging. The man cared and took the time to show it. Mutual friend Cliff McDonald talked about Mike's ability to connect as a friend on a much deeper spiritual level and how that helped him in his life. My observation of him as a husband is simple. Casey covered it beautifully. He was deeply in love with her, and she knew it. Every day, I imagine. He showed her by lifting her up and making decisions about, quote, his life, his career, for example, that weighted her dreams and priorities as much as or more than his own. It was always them together, and the family was their only priority. Compromise, connection, collaboration, consistency. He lived these ideals every day. Again, what a role model. At the end of our football careers at Dartmouth, we voted on team awards. The Manners Maketh Man Award was the most revered. I did a bunch of research about the origin of this theme, and suffice it to say that we were voting for the dude we all loved and who showed up the right way every day as our leader and coach T, and mentor, Coach T, did. Something about those role models. Like this captaincy, voting was a no-brainer. Bo should be the award's namesake. Manners maketh Bobo. He epitomized the role being celebrated, a role which he relished the most, that of teammate. At the outset of this exercise, and I promise I'm getting toward the end, I was thinking about themes. If, like some of us, you grew up in the 80s, there were a couple athletes who jumped off the page. And commerce embraced them too. Be Like Mike from Gatorade is a good one. Bo Nose from Nike is too. But the beautiful people of Seattle adopted number 19 on the Hawks this past summer fall. Mike called it the Bobo Northwest Miracle. And someone, I would like to know who it was, coined hashtag more Bobo. I honestly cannot think of a more perfect way to sum up how I feel, and it has nothing to do with Jake's outstanding play on the field. Not only do I miss my friend more than I can miss anything, but we all need more of what he had to give. And I think the point is that we're supposed to find it within ourselves to bring more Bobo to the world. Together, I think we can do it. Another dear friend of Bo's, Mike Fye, told me that in his most recent exchange with him in January, our captain told him, "This is going to bring you all closer together." To hear that kind of thought from someone facing what he faced, humbling and inspiring, isn't it? We tell our children to treat others how you would like to be treated. We'll look around. What a life this man lived, and what a legacy he leaves. Casey, thank you again for this opportunity to celebrate Mike's life. And I, along with my family and so many others, sincerely hope to make some new memories with you and the boys in the years to come. For all who are comfortable doing so, and as Mike did with me a few weeks ago, please share a hand now with the person next to you so we may give thanks. And thanks for hanging in there with me. We love you, Michael James Bobo. And I love all of you who are here today and those of you listening because he loved you. God bless you, Bo, and may you rest in eternal peace as we carry forward on your behalf with all the goodness and kindness you provided as our anchor. You lit the path, and following it is the only proper way forward. We're all hurting right now, but maybe, just maybe, we're actually doing better than we deserve because we got to spend meaningful parts of our lives with you. To my guy, the OG number 19, thank you for everything, Mike Bobo. Amen.
Thank you so much to everyone who has shared from the depth of their hearts about this amazing man. As a pastor, this is one of the hardest parts of our job, is how do we help a family make sense of such an unexpected and untimely death of someone who was clearly so full of life and health until about 3 months ago. And I'm embarrassed to say that I had no idea Mike had gotten sick. I knew that he hadn't been at Grace Chapel most of the fall for something that kept taking him out of town, I don't know. Apparently he's kind of into football. We were expecting him back in January or February because there was a young man that was waiting for him to come back and be his shine buddy. I found myself thinking, as I'm listening to all these stories that you all shared, I knew so little of Mike Bobo. What I knew was he was this incredibly sweet man who came on Sunday mornings to hang out with a child with special needs. He was a shine buddy. That's our ministry, to children with special needs so that their moms and dads can go to worship. That's who I knew Mike was. I didn't know about Procter & Gamble. I didn't know about Dartmouth football. I didn't even know that Jake was like famous or something. Although one of my youth workers did, because when I told him that I was with the Bobo family, he went, "What? Wait, Jake Bobo from Seattle?" I'm like, "Yeah, am I supposed to?" Oh, dear. So when I got Casey's email a few weeks ago, I was stunned, as I'm sure many of you were, to hear news of just how sick Mike was. I remember calling Casey right away, and I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And I'm so thankful that I was able to speak with Mike later that day. He was fairly upbeat, which sounds pretty par for the course. He was kind of matter-of-fact. "Yeah, Ruthie, I'm kind of sick. Trying to get these blood clots under control." I prayed with him over the phone, and I made a promise that I would get in touch with our senior pastor, Brian, who was in Florida on vacation. I understand that he and Mike texted almost daily after that. And Brian does so wish he could be here today. As luck would have it, or as we tend to think in God's divine providence, Brian happened to need to come home for a few days of that month-long vacation. And he was able to go in town and see Mike in the hospital. They read scripture. He prayed with Mike and the family literally minutes before Mike went home to be with Jesus. Mike loved Brian's preaching. And when I visited the family last week, they went and found this box of journals, one of which was filled with notes from sermons. And I don't remember if it was Luke or Jake, but one of you picked it up and went, "Oh, this is the Brian Wilkerson journal." I told Brian that, and he looked just a little embarrassed. Some of the other journals had some different entries, even memorabilia, movie and concert tickets, the stubs that he had saved, memories to be able to go back and revisit, to relive the experiences and the laughter as the years would go by, notes about funny things the boys said or did over the years. Some of you may be getting a little nervous, like wondering, am I in one of those journals? You might want to check with the boys. But one that you shared with me is too priceless not to mention. Apparently, Mac, when you were born, you were quite the beautiful baby. Everyone wanted to hold you, kiss you, touch you, especially your older brothers. But when you were old enough to talk, I guess you were getting sick of all that brotherly love, because Mike wrote down something you said, beginning with the words that you heard your mom say frequently, "Hands to self." Only the whole phrase that Mike noted was, "Hands to self, only Daddy and Mom can touch me, and especially no kisses for Jake." I found it poignant when you told me this story, Casey, that you and the boys are realizing is that Mike has actually given you a gift in those journals. His words and his memories of being with you that will now last you a lifetime. And on the days when he seems far away, pull out one of those journals, and just maybe you'll sense his presence on the couch next to you through his words. Other journals may capture some of his spiritual journey, his walk with God, which began at a very early age at his mom's side. Barbara, your family has painted for me a beautiful picture of the relationship that you shared with Mike. In fact, they were wondering if either of you could ever exist on this earth without the other. But we are so grateful that you are here and able to celebrate his life with us. And as we were talking about what scriptures to highlight at this service, Jake, you took us to the one you just read. Those words are found in the 20th chapter of the book of Acts. The book of Acts was written by the Apostle Paul's companion, Luke, who, like Mike Bobo, was a faithful follower of Christ and a prolific writer, taking great care to write down the teachings and memories of his travels and experiences in the early years of the church. In chapter 20, Paul is speaking words of encouragement and instruction to the leaders of the church in a city called Ephesus. In fact, when you said you wanted to read just verse 24 and you wondered, is it too short? I then took the liberty to read aloud some of the verses surrounding that one verse. And in so doing, I was struck by how those words could be Mike's words of farewell to us, and especially to you, Jake, Luke, and Mac. Friends, listen to these words that provide context for the one that Jake read just a few moments ago, and see if you who knew Mike well don't also hear his voice behind these words of farewell that Paul wrote to those he loved. Now, I know that none of you among whom I have gone about preaching the kingdom will ever see me again. For I have not hesitated to proclaim to you the whole will of God. Keep watch over yourselves and all of the flock of which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers. Be shepherds of the church of God, which he bought with his own blood. Now I commit you to God and to the word of his grace, which can build you up and give you an inheritance among all those who are sanctified. I have not coveted anyone's silver or gold or clothing. You yourselves know that these hands of mine have supplied my own needs and the needs of my companions. In everything I did, I showed you that by this kind of hard work, we must help the weak. Remembering the words the Lord Jesus himself said, it's more blessed to give than receive. When Paul had finished speaking, he knelt down with all of them and prayed, and they all wept as they embraced him and kissed him. And what grieved them most was his statement that they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship. There are a couple of themes I hear in this passage that remind me of Mike and give us reminders of him to carry with us. From what the boys told me, Mike never hesitated to proclaim to them the life-giving truths of the scripture, sending text messages almost daily of Bible verses to encourage them. What a beautiful way for you guys to honor your dad, if you from time to time do the same for one another. Paul speaks of his own hard work to supply his needs. And Casey, you told me of what a loyal and hard worker Mike was at Procter & Gamble since graduation from Dartmouth. So may we all honor our love and memories of Mike by working hard at what each of us has been called and gifted to do. Mike also had a passion to help the weak. The way Mike chose to serve in the life of Grace Chapel was to be a one-on-one buddy to some of our children with special needs through the Shine ministry. We even have a couple of his Shine colleagues here today. If you see someone with a bright orange lanyard, that's who they are. If you do not have a place where you are currently serving someone else in your church, in your place of worship, in your community, we encourage you to look for what might honor Mike and reflect both his love and God's love. If we do these things, we would not only honor Mike, but also be able to speak the words that Jake read earlier with humble confidence. I consider my life worth nothing to me. My only aim is to finish the race and complete the task the Lord Jesus has given me, the task of testifying to the good news of God's grace. On February 24th, I have no doubt that Mike heard, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the place of your rest." Or perhaps Jesus said it a little differently. "Mike, I love you and I'm proud of you." I know the swiftness of Mike's passing has left you all feeling a bit adrift, like you're floating through your days, stuck a bit on what comes next in your family life together. Well, rather than feeling stuck, what if you consider that you are anchored? Anchored to the love you hold for your husband and your father and your brother and your friend. anchored to his love for you. Anchored, secure, not just because of Mike's love for you, but because the source of Mike's love was the love of God within him that kept him anchored. Now think about these words from that anchored perspective and hear Mike's heart as you reflect on the words of Paul penned by his companion Luke. And when you're ready to pull up anchor, know that you have the power that raised Jesus from the dead flowing in you and through you and propelling you forward. The final verse of this section of scripture said this: what grieved them most was his statement they would never see his face again. Then they accompanied him to the ship. And I shared with you a story that was read at my dad's graveside many years ago that I want to close with today, attributed to Henry Van Dyke. I am standing upon the seashore. A ship at my side spreads her white sails to the moving breeze and starts for the blue ocean. She is an object of beauty and strength. I stand and watch her until at length she hangs like a speck of white cloud just where the sea and sky come to mingle with each other. Then someone at my side says, "There, she's gone." Gone where? Gone from my sight, that is all. She is just as large in mast, hull, and spar as she was when she left my side. And she is just as able to bear her load of living freight to her destined port. Her diminished size is in me, not in her. And just at that moment, when someone says, "There, she's gone," there are eyes watching her coming and other voices ready to take up the glad shout, "Here she comes." And that is dying. Casey, Jake, Luke, Mac, you accompanied Mike to the ship. Friends, hear this good news. Mike may be gone from our sight, and we will indeed miss him. And it is good and right to grieve on this side the loss that we feel. But know this, a chorus is being raised on a distant shore and was raised a few weeks ago with one voice in particular, clear and loud and articulate. His nephew George saying, "Here he comes. It's Uncle Mike." Someday the chorus will rise up for each one of us who name the name of Jesus Christ. And we will experience a family reunion like none of us has ever had. May it be so. Amen. Please pray with me. Our gracious and loving God, we come before you today with mixed emotions. We are deeply grateful for the life of Michael James Bobo. We are so thankful for the family and friends present here today. Father, out of your immeasurable and unconditional love for us, you have provided a way for us to face these moments in hope and not despair because of the work of Jesus on the cross and the miracle of his resurrection. We give you thanks, Lord Jesus, that you did not leave us to navigate this life alone, but you sent the Holy Spirit, without whom we would be lost without any promise of eternity, wandering aimlessly, unanchored, in search of the purpose of life. Thank you, Lord, that Mike knew these truths to the core of his being and was quick to share it with anyone who came across his path, texting verses of scripture frequently to his boys, to friends, to anyone whose name you laid upon his heart, gestures that have made memories that will last his family and friends a lifetime. But this is truly a bittersweet time. We will all miss Mike deeply the next time the family goes to the Dominican, when football season starts back up again. College graduations and weddings and other special moments, Mike's absence will be deeply felt. At the same time, we are filled with joy that he is now in your presence without pain, without any discomfort, fully healed and made whole. We lift Casey to you. We give thanks for the example of love and commitment she and Mike modeled in their life together. Comfort her with the sweet and tangible presence of their family and with the strength and consolation of the Holy Spirit through our prayers. We bring before you Jake, Luke, Mac, Mickey and Matt, Mike's mom, Casey's sisters, all their families, Jerry, and all those other friends and colleagues who were so close to Mike. And ask, Holy Spirit, that you would bring comfort where there is sadness, bring healing where there is pain, bring reconciliation if there has been division. Give each one a sense of your gracious love. Bring to mind sweet memories of their dad, brother, uncle, and friend. Continue to give them moments of laughter as well as tears. Surprise them with expressions of love for one another and for Mike as they begin the work of living life without him nearby, but remind them daily that he lives still, praising you at the foot of your throne. Be gracious, Lord, to heal their hearts with the comfort and constant presence of your Spirit. Remind us all that this is but a momentary period of separation. We look forward to being reunited not only with Mike, but with other loved ones who are in paradise with you, where there are no more tears, where all relationships are healed, where pain and grief no longer hold any power. We give thanks for this sure and certain hope. And it is with this confidence that we pray this prayer in the name of Jesus, Mike's Lord and Savior, using the words that Jesus taught all those who would follow him to pray. And together we pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Friends, in a moment after the benediction, I will escort the family back out of the sanctuary. There is a beautiful spread of food at the reception, so we encourage you have a choice to stand and greet the family or go ahead and eat and then take turns coming back out to see them. We wouldn't want you all to just be standing in line for the next 7 hours. So I invite you to stand and receive the benediction. Go back into the world in peace. Have courage. Hold tight to that which is good. Never return anyone evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the suffering. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit, who is at work within you and flowing through you. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the comforting presence of the Holy Spirit be with each of you this day and every day. May it be so. Amen. Thank you.